In a roundabout way, our first story is connected with the world's oil supplies, because some very smart people in Australia reckon there could be some positive spin-offs for wool growers from the move by the world's oil-producing countries to cut supply of crude. For a start, it may force up the price of synthetic fibres and increase demand for our wool. And it may also spur on development of a safe, efficient and affordable alternative to petrochemicals that's straight off the sheep's back.
This is not so much a yarn about value-adding wool as it is about the byproduct that's turning out to be nearly as valuable as the golden fleece itself. Wool grease is the natural oil that helps make wool water repellent, protecting sheep from the harsh effects of weather. Secreted by the sheep's skin, it continuously collects on the wool so that by the time the fleece is harvested, it makes up between 15 and 25% of the total weight of freshly cut wool. The ancient Greeks were among the first to seize the potential of this natural emollient as a preservative, protectant and lubricant for use in things such as ointments and on everything from clothing and shelters to spears. While this rather crude use of wool grease continued from about 700 BC onwards, it was the late 19th century before a process was developed to refine what we now know as lanolin. These days, it's recovered during a three-stage wool cleaning or scouring process. It's separated from the fleece by a solvent extraction in a process not unlike dry cleaning clothes. After removing the solvent, dirt, debris and whatever a sheep may be rolling around in, you're left with a sticky substance a bit like petroleum jelly. The Adelaide-based G.H. Michel Company is the largest exporter and processor of Australian wool. Almost 500,000 bales, or 15% of the wool clip, is processed at this plant. Michelle's produces about 250 drums of lanolin each week. Almost all of it is exported, destined to be further processed into a surprising range of highly value-added applications, from cosmetics and pharmaceuticals to soaps, polishes, paints, putties and protectant coatings. A few years back it was worth just 50 or 60 cents a kilogram. But these days, lanolin can fetch $3 to $4 a kilo, making a 200 kilogram drum of it worth nearly as much as a bale of wool. Yet that's just a fraction of the lanolin we send overseas, when you remember that it's stuck to 3/4 of our clip that goes abroad as greasy wool. And just as there are a lot of people who'd like to think we could add more value to our wool before sending it overseas, there are some who reckon we could be doing a lot more with the wool grease as well.
And as I said before, targeting the major industries, the export potentials of this product, and what it can really do for the environment and cleaner production.
So in a sense, you want to keep the potential of that, particularly the export potential, within Australia rather than just exporting it as another raw material along with the wool.
Well, that's right, and I think the farmers should have some involvement in this. Either some of the benefits going back to the man on the land or into planting trees, or maybe a wool growers cooperative being involved in this product so that we can always secure plenty of wool grease and gives them an opportunity to make something out of it, because it does belong to the man on the land.
Jeff Boyle's been a boxing champ, a ringer and a racehorse trainer in a knockabout working life that's taken him from one end of the country to the other. He's been in Brisbane for the past few years, tinkering with an idea he's had since he worked on fishing boats in North Queensland. Jeff takes the raw material straight from the scourers, and through a series of processes he'd prefer to keep to himself, he further purifies, filters and distills it into a range of food-grade quality liquid lanolin products and greases.
Well, basically what I was after is a product that not only had lubrication, but corrosion protection properties. So, and also the versatility of a product that could replace a lot of petrochemical products and yet have the versatility and the biofriendliness to go alongside with it.
Like a lot of promising projects, Jeff figures so far this has been 1% inspiration and the rest perspiration.
How hard is it to get a new product like this off the ground?
Very hard, very hard. And that was a big problem there for a long time, you know, like leaving North Queensland and coming down to Brisbane. And once I developed the product and done me testing, then started knocking on doors. You know, and instead of just going straight to the boating community, I went straight to the major players like Energex and councils and railways and mining, and which took a long time for them to do their testing and start giving the product a bit of a thumbs up.
I use it in my workshop. I use it on a multitude of things. Sticky windows, door keys that won't work, people's petrol caps that won't come undone, leather, shoes that are not weatherproof. Spray it on your shoes, they become weatherproof within minutes, basically. It's just an amazing product, and it's all natural.
Mike Pierce is a mechanic who figures if anyone knows the value of wool grease, a Kiwi would.
Well, a lot of people sort of compare it to WD-40, which is probably the most obviously known one, and I think there's a difference. It's like chalk and cheese. This product you can use on just about everything. It's not a water dispersant agent like WD-40, but it treats metal to stop the water impregnating it, stop rust getting in, or if you've got a really rusty object, if you drop it in lanolin, pull it out again, it'll start working within hours.
But there's a particular pet project out the back that really sold Mike on lanolin. He rescued this old paddock basher, a 46 Ford Ute coupe, a year or so ago from a property at St George.
That's as it came, pretty much rusty state. And then we took it down, sandblasted it, brought it back here straight from the sandblasters, and then coated it liberally with lanolin. It's been like that approximately 18 months. It's been fairly much in the weather, and we're only one street back from the bay. So salt water's pretty prevalent around here, and it says it stayed.
He hasn't even had time to give it a lick of undercoat, yet the woolly waterproofing seems to be working better than a tarpaulin.
We use it when we weld. It's an anti-spatter. You can paint over the top of it. So after doing some work on the vehicle, we can, instead of just undercoating it and having to treat it all again, just walk away from it. Come back to it 2 days, 2 weeks, 2 months later, and it's still exactly as you left it. It hasn't rusted and there's no surface rust, so it's brilliant.
For me, it's replaced a whole shelf full of stuff, and it does just about everything better again.
John Ruth grew up on a sheep station in the Flinders Ranges and was curious whether lanolin would perform as well in the big smoke as well as he remembered it did in the bush.
You know, one of the first things I thought about when all this was happening was our old sheepyards. You know, you never see a sheepyard eaten by white ants or bolts rusted away or any of that sort of stuff. But
given his upbringing, John was also aware that wool grease had fallen out of favour because of the strong chemicals like DDT and arsenic that were routinely used to combat lice and fly strike in sheep. They were readily absorbed into the wool grease, virtually shutting down the viable extraction of lanolin. It's taken the advent of more environmentally sensitive treatments for sheep, better ways of decontaminating wool grease in the scouring process, and a rigorous testing program to give lanolin the all clear and a new working life.
Everybody that I've passed a can to or let use some of mine or whatever has come back with much the same story, you know, where can I get it? And you don't get that with a normal product.